Thanks to Third Love for supporting Mueller, She Wrote. Third Love knows there's a perfect bra for everyone, so right now they're offering our listeners 15% off their first order. Go to thirdlove.com/AG now to find your perfect fitting bra and get 15% off your first purchase. That's thirdlove.com/AG for 15% off today. And thanks to Ritual for supporting Mueller, She Wrote. Better health doesn't happen overnight, so start your year with Essential for Women, a vitamin subscription service, a small step that helps create a healthy foundation for 2019 and beyond. Mueller junkies can visit ritual.com/AG for a free trial. That's ritual.com/AG to start your ritual today.
So to be clear, Mr. Trump has no financial relationships with any Russian oligarchs.
That's what he said. That's what I said. That's obviously what our position is.
I'm not aware of any of those activities. I have been called a surrogate at a time or two in that campaign, and I didn't have communications with the Russians.
What do I have to get involved with Putin for? I have nothing to do with Putin. I've never spoken to him. I don't know anything about him other than he will respect me. Russia, if you're listening, I hope you're able to find the 30,000 emails that are missing.
So, it is political. You're a communist.
No, Mr. Green. Communism is just a red herring. Like all members of the oldest profession, I'm a capitalist.
Hello, and welcome to Mueller, She Wrote. I'm your host, A.G., and with me as always is Jaleesa Johnson.
Hello.
And Jordan Coburn.
Hello.
Thank you all so much for becoming patrons and pushing us over the 3,000 mark. We will now be recording midweek episodes for our patrons every week, probably to be released later Wednesday nights or Thursday morning, depending on your time zone. So patrons, keep an eye out for that. If you want to grab the second episode every week, become a patron by going to patreon.com/MuellerSheWrote. You'll also get the key to all our bonus episodes, our newsletter, an invitation to our closed Facebook group where you can play the Fantasy Indictment League, ad-free episodes, free gifts, all kinds of stuff. So that's all I'm going to say about that, because we have a jam-packed episode this week. It is our season premiere, season three. Premiere, wee!
Yay!
And we have some amazing new guests, including former U.S. attorney from the Eastern District of Michigan and one of my favorite MSNBC contributors, Barbara McQuade. And we have a very special appearance from Marcy Wheeler of Empty Wheel. I'm so excited she's joining us. I've been wanting her to come on and talk to us for a while now. In Hot Notes today, Jordan's going to tell us about John Kelly's parting words on Trump in an L.A. Times interview. Jaleesa has a story about House Republicans looking for a lawyer, and I'm going to talk about a secret Mueller filing in the Sam Patten case. So, guys, how was your New Year's? What'd you do?
It was great. I feel like I'm having deja vu. We didn't talk about New Year's. We talked about Christmas last time, right?
I did
the same thing. Netflix. Yeah, I watched Bird Box.
How'd you like it? I heard things.
I loved it. Yeah. It was amazing, yeah.
Yeah, I hosted a New Year's show at Madhouse, which was really fun. But it was kind of weird because every year the New Year's crowds actually are kind of shitty. Because, yeah, one of our waitresses, she described it really well. She's like, I think it's just because it's a bunch of people that want to party, but they want to sit down.
So that's partiers.
The vibe of them. Yeah, they just were pretty tight. But it was fun.
Yeah, New Year's crowds are tight.
Yeah.
They're pretty tight.
How was yours?
Good. Did a show at the Palace.
Oh, yeah.
They were loose AF.
Oh, good.
It must be a Kearney Mesa thing.
They weren't sitting in their chairs.
It was really fun. It was sold out. And we had the whole countdown and everything. It was nice. Well, we have a few corrections for this week. First of all, I called Chuck Schumer Chuck Grassley. I've done this a lot of times. I get my old white Chucks mixed up. Sorry about that. Amber wanted to remind us that the flu is very serious, and we seemingly dismissed it as something that could easily be detected and cured when we spoke about the Guatemalan boy who died in Border Patrol custody last week. So thank you, Amber. Well reminded. The flu is very serious. It's the Elite Eight in the NCAA tournament. So thanks to our sports fans for pointing that out. Civilian federal workers received a 1.9% pay raise last year, not 2.4%, which is what the military got. So thanks for reminding me. I got that raise. I should have known. Then it was that. We won't get anything this year, but, you know, that's how the cookie crumbles, I guess.
Bummer.
A lot of people aren't even getting their paychecks, so that's a whole other story.
Yeah, and back pay, right? Like, some people aren't getting that at all.
Yeah, contractors who work for the government won't get anything.
That's crazy.
Yeah, it's ridiculous. Let's see. I said Steve King instead of Peter King, who said that, you know, well, only two kids have died. Remember when you pointed that out, Jordan?
Yeah.
It was Peter King, not Steve King. Both assholes, but this was the Peter kind. It's been pointed out to me by someone in the know that it's pronounced German Kahn, not Hermann Kahn. That's the father-in-law of Van der Zwan, who was indicted by Mueller's team. And he's also one of the guys at Alpha Bank. So thanks. Good looking out. We didn't really have a story about German Kahn last week, but somebody just felt the need to point that
out. I'm glad they mentioned that because I always think of Hermann Cain when I hear Hermann Kahn. So this is better.
Yeah, this is better. German. German Kahn.
Kahn. That's how he wished his name was pronounced.
Yeah.
It sounds more regal.
Yeah. Just, hey, let us know. Ada, you know, send us an email. Hello at Mueller, She Wrote, if you've got any corrections or anything you want to talk about. Or you can tweet us at Mueller, She Wrote. Or go to our website, MuellerSheWrote.com, click contact, and let us know about corrections you may have. All that being said, we have a lot of news to get to this week, so let's kick it off with just the facts. All right, all the way back to Sunday, guys. The Washington Post reported that federal prosecutors in New York have requested records from Deutsche Bank related to a $285 million real estate loan they gave Kushner and his family 1 month prior to the 2016 election. We reported this back in June of this year when we learned that Kush purchased four floors in the New York Times headquarters building and got $74 million more than he paid for the property. Now Kush, at that time, was the head of the company, Kush Real Estate, whatever it is, and he said he failed to report the loans on his financial disclosures because he didn't have an obligation to pay it back. So therefore, he didn't have to report it as a loan.
Yeah.
As we all know, Deutsche Bank has been fined several times on a variety of legal issues, including a $7.2 billion fine for mortgage abuse and a $425 million fine related to money laundering in 2016 and 2017, respectively. So it's important to note that these investigations are separate from Mueller's investigation, but it's known that special counsel is investigating Kushner's business dealings as well. So there's probably some overlap. There's a Venn diagram happening.
Oh, yeah. Then the Saudis get involved in so many angles there, too.
Yeah, Qatar. He's got a lot of money from a lot of people. Also Sunday, John Kelly painted a dim portrait of Trump in the Los Angeles Times interview he did, and Jordan will have that for us in Hot Notes. Then Monday, Mueller filed a sealed update in the Samuel Patten case, and I'll go over that later in the show because this is really important and it sort of slipped under the radar.
Mm-hmm.
Also Monday, Elizabeth Warren announced her bid for the presidency in 2020.
Not a surprise.
Yep. She's going to get a committee together and see if it's a feasible thing for her.
How do you guys feel about that, just off the top?
I mean, if I get a free ancestry DNA test out of it, I'm cool.
We all get 23andMe.
23 and Liz.
Black people have the same experience on there. It's always back to the same thing.
I think it's great. I want to see a giant, huge, diverse field in the
the election, like the candidacy?
Yeah. In the primaries. Mm-hmm. And like I said, and I've said this a million times, fight like hell for your candidate. But then whoever wins, vote for that person.
Exactly.
Definitely.
Just do that.
Yeah, I agree. Throw out the feelers on all different kinds of people. See what sticks, what we need to do to take over the White House.
Everybody's generally a pretty cool person who's going to be running on the Democratic ticket. We don't have any giant a-holes.
Yeah, not right now, I guess.
God, some people would beg to differ.
Wiener's gone, so.
The bar is pretty low, though.
Yeah. Barney Frank was the last asshole Democrat we had.
I mean, all you have to do is be better than Trump.
That's true. That's true. The bar's low.
It is. Also, the Daily Beast spoke to a person familiar with Trump's legal team's strategy for fighting the Mueller report on Monday, saying they intend to cite executive privilege. Particularly in the obstruction case, we all assume that the Mueller report will be in part about obstruction of justice and could involve testimony from White House staff who heard Trump talk about why he fired Comey, such as Don McGahn or Reince Priebus, Mole. But according to Giuliani, Trump can claim executive privilege and bar Mueller from sharing that testimony with anyone outside the executive branch, reminding us that he can only give his report to the attorney general and only the attorney general can decide if that report moves forward to Congress. However, we now have the Jaworski report roadmap that was recently released from the Watergate case, setting precedent that grand jury findings can be submitted directly to the House Judiciary Committee, which is now chaired by Jerry Nadler, a Democrat. So put some beans on that. And later on in the show, I'm going to talk to Barbara McQuade about that kind of path, way forward. She's so good. Then Tuesday, Mitt Romney wrote a scathing op-ed in the Washington Post about Trump being a giant piece of shit, basically. And that falls right into line with a scenario we've been talking about for over a year now. We call it the Romney 20. It was the Comey 6.
Yeah.
The Romney 20. Mormons refer to this as the White Horse Prophecy. We were notified by one of our Mormon listeners. This prophecy has been repudiated by the Church of LDS, but basically what it says is at some point, our democracy will be hanging by a thread during a constitutional crisis, and a Mormon will come riding on a shiny white horse out of the West to Washington, D.C., and will save the country from certain demise. What we're saying is that if Mitt Romney, we were saying that if Mitt Romney won his Senate seat in Utah, he could go to D.C. and recruit enough Republican senators to reach the 67 votes needed to remove him from office if he's impeached in the House. So Romney would need to win the Senate seat. He's done that. And now with his op-ed, he's made clear he doesn't like Trump, calling December one of the worst months for Trump. And basically, he's a shit president. So his opinion is clear. And there's been a lot of folks saying we shouldn't praise Romney. He's an a-hole. And we're not. We're simply saying the White Horse prophecy still stands.
Yeah. And didn't he recently say that he like supports the wall after he put out the op-ed?
Yeah, he did.
So what's the deal with Romney? I feel like he could still save us and support the wall. But I mean, what an a-hole.
Yeah, I was not a giant fan of that article because it was just like championing all of these quote unquote wins that are super GOP oriented wins that generally really fucking suck. But because he's like, but Trump sucks, people are like, yay, Romney.
Mm-hmm. He's still a Republican.
You're right.
I disagree with everything mm-hmm. that he stands for ever in the history of the universe.
My enemy's enemy, though, right?
Well, I mean, if anyone can get any senators to turn on him, on Trump, it would be Romney. That's what we've been saying.
Yeah. They need someone, I guess, on their side for it to work.
I'm just wary of people supporting him because of him taking down Trump or something, and then because he'll probably run for president, and then if he wins, then it's just going to be more, honestly, of like the same policy. Not the same policy, but
right, same old
same GOP,
GOP
policy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But he was correct about Trump being a piece of shit. So
oh, yeah. You're
no,
right.
I don't agree with his politics. Don't at me. But he could convince enough Republicans to oust Trump if it comes to that. You can read the op-ed, and a link we'll send out in the newsletter for patrons this week. And speaking of, Jordan, you just finished uploading all the past newsletters to the patron page, so you have access to those now.
Yeah. Yay. If you're not a patron and you want to see every single article we've ever referenced on this show in the last year, then become a patron. It's pretty cheap at our lowest level, and it's all listed there for you.
Yep. And you get all sorts of stuff. Let's see. Thursday, Mueller filed a motion in the Concord management case. This is one of the entities that was indicted by Mueller, one of the Russian entities, and they've been fighting a battle to send Mueller's discovery back to Russia. And in this filing, Mueller asks to file its opposition to Concord management's motion to compel under seal because the government's opposition discusses a matter that's occurring before the grand jury, so it's secret. We'll keep you posted on this case. You can put beans on Mueller winning all of his motions against Concord Management. We'll have a photo of that filing and the photos we sent out in the newsletter, so check out that. It's just a paragraph that says, we want to file this under motion because there's some secret shit going down.
Yeah.
Thanks, Bob Mueller.
If we had a fantasy league for Mueller's motions, it wouldn't be fair because he would always win. It's yeah, like too predictable.
I'm going to put all of his motions on my team and I will win everything.
What does under motion mean, legal jargon wise?
Under seal?
Under seal. Under motion means under seal.
No, did I say under motion?
Yes.
Oh, motion under seal.
Got it.
He wants to file the motion under seal.
Cool.
Under motion.
He's under motion. Yeah, like I've never heard that before.
Sounds like a weird 80s dance, doesn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah.
Cue Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez.
Oh, yeah.
Thursday, the House Republicans are apparently seeking an investigative lawyer. That was reported Thursday, and Jaleesa will have that for us later in Hot Notes. Also Thursday, we found out what happened with Alderman Burke. It has nothing to do with Mueller or Trump so far. Burke is the longest-serving alderman in the history of Chicago. On that city council, and he's facing federal corruption charges for blackmailing Burger King into using his private tax firm by refusing to permit the remodel of one of their restaurants in Chicago. Restaurants is a strong word. prosecutors raided his office and papered the windows 5 weeks ago. Remember, everyone was like, ooh, what is it?
Yeah.
It was the same day Deutsche Bank was raided or something.
Mm-hmm.
And apparently they tapped his cell phone and they have recordings of conversations of him telling Burger King flat out that he'd hold them up in their permits if they didn't get their taxes done with his private firm.
Wow.
We had thought that since he handled Trump's tax returns for his tower in Chicago for 12 years, that it had to do with that. But anyway, you have the facts. My conjecture is they might have found stuff on Trump during the raid. So, Alderman Beans.
Yeah, Alderman Beans. That really pisses me off because I heard that he, you know, had this scam, I guess, or like this weird holdup. But I didn't know he was so blunt with them, like the recordings. That's crazy.
Yeah, he was like, I'm not going to do. They wanted to put a driveway in. Mm-hmm. And he's like, I'm not going to get that permit approved if you don't hire my tax firm to do your taxes.
Wow. That's way too ballsy. They're so, like, bold right now. Like, yeah. This, you know, white-collar crime.
And Rahm Emanuel was like, that's fucked up. And that's coming from Rahm Emanuel. Like, he's... Yeah. He's special.
Stuff like that goes on all the time. That's how the 1% even happens. So it's nice to see something actually uncovered, I guess. But I know that's happening all the goddamn time.
Yeah.
Also Thursday, it was reported that an American named Paul Whelan was arrested in Russia for espionage. U.S. intelligence officers say that his resume suggests he's the last person the U.S. would use to collect evidence because we would never send someone to Russia to spy that didn't have diplomatic immunity, which Whelan apparently does not have. And they suggest that the Russians are likely to distort his background to suggest he was engaged in espionage. And here with us to discuss Whelan is independent journalist and publisher of The Empty Wheel, Marcy Wheeler. Marcy, welcome to Mueller, She Wrote.
Hey, great to be on finally.
I'm so glad to have you. So many people seem to think they were teeing this up, that suggesting that the arrest of Whelan is posturing to trade for Maria Butina. However, you posit that it's more likely it has to do with Rosneft. So I was wondering if you could explain your thoughts on that.
No, I don't think it has to do with Rosneft, but I think that I don't think anyone has a solid explanation for Whelan, what he was doing there, why the Russians arrested him. The easy explanation is that it's Butina, but that doesn't make sense, really, in part because she's been cooperating since September. And she will go home, you know, basically once she gets sentenced. So she's on her way home one way or another. Russia doesn't need to trade anyone to get her. And it's, I think people have a very hopeful notion of what she may be cooperating on. I think it is distinctly possible she's only cooperating on Paul Erickson. So for all of those reasons, I don't think Butina explains it. I did suggest one possible explanation is not Rosneft, but there's this other dude who got arrested in North Carolina. And he is... I'm going to try and go find his name because otherwise I'll butcher it. His name is Leonid Taif, and he was arrested basically for money laundering money from the Russian defense industry, but also for contract killing, trying to get his wife knocked off. And you wouldn't think that that has any tie, except that that's been unsealed much more recently than the Butina stuff. And that guy... this Taif guy has ties to Yevgeny Prigozhin. So, you know, he has ties to the guy who is sending out mercenaries for Vladimir Putin. He has ties to the guy who's sending out here in the United States all these bots and trolls for Vladimir Putin. So he, and it's unclear what he was doing with all this money laundering and these safe houses. And I'm just suggesting he may be a far more interesting person to Vladimir Putin than Butina. You know, if they wanted to trade for Butina, they would have done it back in July or back in, you know, September before she did start cooperating. So that's my argument as far as that goes.
Yeah, and that makes sense because in Butina's plea agreement, one of the paragraphs is her immigration, deals with her immigration. It says she will be deported when all this is finished. And like you were talking about with the only thing she's cooperating on is Erickson. I remember when the arguments came to, you know, the government wanted to keep the gag order on her. And it was basically because of Erickson, in so many words, not only him, but anyone else that he might help cooperate or, you know, indict or charge or at least be interviewed. So I totally get that point. The only thing that's weird to me is that his resume and his military record, which aren't good, and the fact that he's a citizen in like four countries seems to make him an excellent target to be recruited by FSB, doesn't it?
Yeah, I mean, I think the notion of, I mean, I hate to be false flag about everything, but hey, the Russians do it. The Russians do false flags. And I think it is not inconceivable that instead he's a Russian asset and they're trying to reel him in for something, or that, you know, he's crossed them and they're trying to retaliate for that. And I think that that is more consistent with his, I mean, I think his military record, right? So he, as far as we know, got a dishonorable discharge, which his family somehow doesn't know about. And he went on with that dishonorable discharge to get a series of increasingly responsible global security jobs, first at Kelly Services and then in for an auto parts supplier here in Michigan. And, you know, that doesn't make sense. But one of the reasons.
Yeah, and it wasn't just a dishonorable. It was a bad conduct, which is even right. worse.
Right. For as I understand it, among other things, claiming to be somebody he wasn't. So, you know, a good reason why you might think the Russians would try and recruit him. And, you know, BorgWarner, his company, doesn't have any ties to Russia, but he keeps going to Russia. He has a contact day account. So I don't think anyone knows. And I'm not, you know, I'm not wedded to any explanation for him. I just don't think Butina is the most likely explanation given what we've seen in her plea agreement.
Okay, so kind of the feeling here is that this is just not as big a deal as everyone's making it out to be, pretty much.
No, it could be, but it might be that we just don't understand it yet. I mean, I think, you know, there's such a rush to assume what's in front of our face is what's most interesting. And I'm sure you've learned by now, as I have, that we're not looking at the most interesting stuff. No one's sharing that with us, either Putin or Mueller. And so there could be entirely different things going on that we don't get to see. And you know, this dude is a Trump guy. And so it could be that, you know, like I said, it could be he actually is a Russian recruit. And for some reason, the Russians need to make sure he doesn't return home anytime soon. I don't know the answer, but I'm not going to assume that I do know.
Yeah, it's all super speculative at this point. And you're right. The things we know are probably the least interesting things.
Right, which is why I'm sort of looking at that case in North Carolina, because boy, is that an interesting case. And you know, it wouldn't be as interesting to me, except he's money laundering into the United States some of the stuff that I think he was working with Prigozhin on. And this is the kind of thing that, of course, Putin, you know, Putin's allies are allowed to steal money from the Russian government left and right. And, you know, is the U.S. government trying to expose that in this case? Could be. I don't know.
Awesome. Well, hey, do me a favor. Can you tell me where people can follow you?
I'm at emptywheel.net for the site and at emptywheel for my very high volume Twitter account.
Awesome. Well, it's been great having you on. Everybody, publisher of Empty Wheel, independent journalist Marcy Wheeler. Thanks for being on Mueller, She Wrote today.
Thanks for having me.
That's so great to finally get Marcy Wheeler on.
Yeah.
We've been following her since the beginning. All right, on to Thursday. We were still on Thursday when seven Republicans broke with their party to vote for Nancy Pelosi's bill to end the government shutdown, offering no money for the wall. That was Thursday night. I've gotten my hopes up about Republicans defecting from Team Trump before, so I'm not going to hang my star on any of them turning on him, but we'll keep you posted.
Mm-hmm.
Every 3 months we're like, it's the beginning of the end. They're jumping ship, and they never jump ship. Also Thursday, a Bloomberg report says Wilbur Ross will be one of the first Trump officials called by Democrats to testify in front of the House Committee on Oversight and Reform. Elijah Cummings, the panel's new chairman, says that they want to question him about allegations that Wilbur Ross has given misleading testimony on multiple occasions about the decision to add a question about citizenship on the 2020 census. Citizenship. I don't know why I said it so weird. Saying he may have committed a crime if he wasn't truthful about how that decision was reached. Because Ross testified that the decision to include the question on the census came solely from the Justice Department in a request made in December 2017. But Dems say internal documents show Ross was taking steps to add the question way before that. So I'm surprised, though, that they don't want to chat with him about his connects with Putin and the Kremlin or his ties to Deutsche Bank or that he was vice chair of the Bank of Cyprus when its Russia-based businesses were sold to an oligarch with ties to Sberbank. And that's a sanctioned bank following the annexation of Crimea sanctions. So perhaps the Intel or Judiciary Committee will question him on those issues. But this is the Oversight and Reform Committee. So we'll see.
Wow. They'll get to it.
Might not be. He might be like, that's not our job so much as that's the judiciary's job.
Mm-hmm. And what's their timeline? You know when they're going to, everything's so backed up, I guess, right?
Yeah, I think they're just trying to open the government right now.
Yeah.
But yeah, they want, Elijah Cummings wants Wilbur Ross to come have a seat.
Yeah, he came up in the Panama Papers, I believe, right? Like he was the earlier player with all the financial speculations. Yeah.
Yeah, definitely. So last week, we reported on a big story from Time magazine that an ex-Russian spy named Boyarkin had told reporters he handled Deripaska's money for him and that Manafort owed Deripaska $19 million, but agreed to give to get private briefings from him through Konstantin Kalimnik to pay off his debts to the Russian oligarch. Another part of that Time magazine article had to do with Montenegro. And this week, Maddow did a story on where Trump gets his weird political opinions about things like Russia and Afghanistan wars and Montenegro. And she talked about a coup that was being organized in Montenegro to stop them from joining NATO. And that coup was backed by pro-Putin Russians. Mm-hmm. She even showed that video that we've talked about several times of Trump shoving the prime minister of Montenegro out of the way during that first G20.
Yeah, that poor guy.
Just pushed him aside and buttoned his coat, and the guy's all, whatever, dick. what she left out, and I was yelling at the TV, she left out that Deripaska is one of the oligarchs in Russia leading the effort, he was leading the effort to discredit Montenegro because they had seized one of his biggest aluminum smelters, and that Deripaska hired Manafort to help him organize the efforts to prevent Montenegro from joining NATO.
Oh, shit.
It's go ahead.
No, so I was just going to say, smelters?
Yeah, it's a big thing that melts aluminum.
Okay, I think of Austin Powers Goldmember, like, smelting.
Smelting. I love gold. It's just so odd that Trump hates Montenegro so much, since no one else does in the world except for Putin. And his recent comments on Russia invading Afghanistan to help stop terrorism, which is completely wrong, and the only other person in the world that thinks that is, you guessed it, Vladimir Putin. This is just more evidence that he's had extensive chats with Russia about what positions to take against NATO and Montenegro and Russia and Afghanistan wars, which the U.S. armed and aided Afghanistan in those wars, by the way. So how anyone cannot think he's Putin's bitch is just alarming to me.
Yeah, what a poser, too.
Yeah.
Yeah, and so this whole Montenegro thing, Rachel did this whole show, and I'm like, it was Manafort and Deripaska. Why, you know, that's a pretty big connect. I don't know if she covered it the next night, but anyway, I was shouting at the TV. Like, that's my sports.
See, I thought at first, before I knew where Montenegro was, that he was just mad because Negro was in the word, but I think, because they're white, they're totally white.
They're very white. It's a Baltic Serbian
situation. Yeah, it's more political than racial. Yeah.
Definitely. It's like nine white guys who live over there. Friday afternoon, we learned that there's 600,000 people in Montenegro.
Wow. Whoa. It's very manageable.
He's just bullying them, man.
He just, because Putin doesn't like them, because mm-hmm. they wanted to join NATO, and because Deripaska's smelter got seized by them.
Yeah.
So. And it's a really wealthy country?
That's all right, I think. I don't know. I don't know.
They do okay.
I don't know their GDP. All right. They're probably doing better now that they got that smelter.
He had a nice suit, the Montenegro guy. Is he the president? Is
it? He's prime minister.
Prime minister. There we go. Yeah.
Weird. Just weird. What a weird thing to hate. I don't know. He's weird. Friday afternoon, we learned that the D.C. District Court Judge, Beryl Howell, extended the Mueller grand jury for 6 more months. So become a patron today. we're going to start releasing those midweek episodes. We blew through our 3,000 patrons, but that was our goal. Our new goal is 7,000. So. But we have six more months with the same grand jury, which is awesome because this grand jury, convened in July of 2017, is familiar with all the Mueller cases, and Mueller doesn't have to convene a new one and bring them all up to speed. Typically, grand juries are in place for 18 months, and then they can be extended by 6 months if the extension is in the public interest. So that this judge, Beryl Howell, thought it was. This particular grand jury is based in D.C. It's dedicated to the Mueller probe. It's all it does. And Howell granted the extension. We love her. We talked recently about folks thinking the Mueller investigation would end with a report in February. And we thought that was just too soon. So this is kind of an indication of that. He might write something up on obstruction in February, but this investigation is long from over. So,
but can he extend it beyond the 6 months, or is that the last time he can do that with the same group?
I think you can only do it one time.
Okay, so he's probably going to try to wrap it up then, at least.
I would.
By then, yeah.
All right, everybody, get on it. But I don't know if you can ask for less than 6 months. That's something I haven't found out yet. Like, maybe if he only needed 3 months, he would have asked for that. But you might only be allowed to get a 6-month extension. So he might have just taken the biggest one he could get in case he needed as much time as he could get.
May as well.
Yeah.
But you can't extend it for more than 6 months. So even if he thought he was a year away, he wouldn't be able to extend it for that long.
Wow.
Also Friday, we learned that in this week's What the Fuck, we learned that Leonardo DiCaprio has testified in secret before a grand jury in recent months as part of the Department of Justice's investigation into Jolo, the Malaysian guy that stole and laundered billions of dollars from the Malaysian Government Investment Fund, also known as 1MDB. And who happens to also be Jolo, a fundraiser for Donald Trump? And this is a crazy story where Praz Michel from the Fugees, hired Elliot Broidy's investment firm to help launder money for Jolo, and he set up accounts to pay Trump to stop investigating Jolo. What? That's obstruction of justice. Broidy is the winner, one of our favorite guys. He's the one who used Cohen to pay a Playboy playmate $1.6 million to get an abortion and keep her mouth shut. So he was one of Cohen's three clients, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
Hannity, Trump, and Broidy.
Broidy.
What a great...
Crazy. We still don't know who that baby's daddy is. We don't really know for sure.
Yeah, no, we were always thinking, like, Trump actually did it and mm-hmm. Broidy was taking the fall. But yeah. Trump did make payments to other playboys, but not for an abortion, just to shut up.
Mm. Right.
Well, if another dictator props up in 45 years, we'll know.
It's uncanny, yeah. They can't help it.
God. We'll know. I won't be here. You guys have to, you know, keep
we'll
my head alive.
Your head, yeah.
We've been talking. In case you were wondering, I've told Jaleesa and Jordan they need to find a way to freeze my head and keep me alive so I can find out what happens in this investigation.
That's all I work on when we're not recording. It's just figuring out how to do that.
It's a secret. Yeah. Secret plot.
Making progress.
Anyway, DiCaprio's involved because Jolo helped him get funding for The Wolf of Wall Street. The government has since seized the proceeds from that movie. And then Jolo also let DiCaprio gamble on his tab at the Venetian in Vegas, and he gifted him with a Picasso, which Leo has since handed over to the government, $3.2
million. Mm-hmm.
He's like, oh, my bad. Here. I didn't know it came from stolen shit. Sorry.
They're seizing all assets for the movie?
All proceeds.
Sorry, proceeds? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Not assets.
Well, they are, I guess, assets, right?
Just
at that point.
DiCaprio's proceeds?
No, the movie made money.
Right.
So they're...
How the hell do they even do that logistically? That's like, because it goes to so many different people and places.
Yeah, I don't
know.
They
take what they can, I guess. Yeah, like any other kind of, what do you call it, when they repo? They just take whatever they can get, right?
I guess they could, like, seize royalties from this point moving forward. That wouldn't be too hard. But are they, like, going back and taking people's money?
Good question.
I doubt that.
Okay.
I doubt that.
That would
They're
sell.
Probably just, if there's any kind of, net profits from the movie... They seize those because it was funded with laundered money.
Mm-hmm. Right.
The Wolf of Wall Street.
Yeah,
which
what
is hilarious.
Irony, right?
Oh, my goodness. It's like the movie is a documentary now.
Yeah,
it kind of was.
Yeah. And the Fugees are involved and Leo. It's weird. It's crazy.
Leo's a weird guy.
He is an interesting fellow.
He seems like he cares about the environment, though.
Yeah. In a weird sort
he
of
says
way.
So.
Not impressed.
Also, Cambridge Analytica popped up in the news Friday with an update to the story about our U.S. State Department awarding the parent company of Cambridge Analytica, called SCL, a no-bid $500,000 contract to counter ISIS terrorist propaganda. That means they awarded this contract without opening bidding to the public. They just gave it to them, our U.S. State Department under Trump. So we'll keep our eyes on that story for you. And what were Republicans calling big news this week? The politics of dancing. The politics of ooh, feeling good. A video of Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez surfaced showing her dancing when she was in college, and Republicans lost their minds.
Ariel, I cannot let this dance happen.
Ren McCormick made a lot of people stop and think.
I object to that kind of music, and I think you know why.
Because people fornicate to it.
So, Republicans hate dancing, and this is a scandal to them. The video shows AOC doing a dance challenge where people would reenact dances from movies, and she chose to do the Breakfast Club weed-smoking dance, which is actually a better scandal, but Republicans aren't cool enough to know that they were all stoned in that scene.
So, Ahab, kipe on my doobage?
So let's see if I have this straight. Raw-dogging porn stars while your wife is at home with your new baby, paying a woman $1.6 million to get an abortion, grabbing people by the pussy, all cool. But dancing is bad.
Oh, God. They're dancing. They're dancing.
Oh. Freddie, we are going up to my room right now, right to Dr. Schaffhausen.
Oh, God, they're dancing. Take me from this place.
I don't know, guys. This is right up there with that tan suit, gray poupon, the war on Christmas, Hillary's emails. It's
the
so
mustard.
Yeah, mustard. It's so sad to watch them try to fabricate scandals out of thin air. Apparently, all we have to do to trigger Trump supporters is dance.
Dance. All these bad times I'm going through, just dance. Got candy in my heels.
That's like some Salem witch trial shit.
Yeah.
They can't dance. They're up loose. To no good.
It's ridiculous.
Oh, just it. And you know, Pence could be the dad in Footloose.
Oh, definitely.
He could very easily be that guy. But he ended up being reasonable, so I don't see.
Yeah, did you see him swear in the first bisexual congressperson? He actually seemed like he was genuine with her in that moment. Is it just me, or did that seem really strangely comfortable for both of them?
I'd like to see what uncomfortable would look like.
Yeah,
like
I just assume that maybe.
Head. No,
that
I don't
meeting,
want to.
That wall meeting where he just sat there. Like Weekend at Bernie's, that was uncomfortable for him.
Yeah.
He's like, I have to sit here for this whole time. Yeah. Meanwhile, he's like, I'm under investigation. God damn it.
Yeah, he seemed way more comfortable with the bisexual than with Pelosi. So that was interesting.
That's kind of scary, right?
Yeah. He's got to do what he can to get in with the base. Our base. Too late, bro.
Tell about that base.
Oh, no. All right, guys, we'll be right back. Mueller, She Wrote is brought to you by Third Love, creators of the perfect fitting bra. Recently, we all got to go to thirdlove.com and use their amazing fit finder quiz, which was super easy, and we found our perfect fit. Third Love is an industry leader with over 70 sizes, including its exclusive half cup size, which I happen to be, and was never able to find the perfect bra until I went on Third Love. Half of women fall between cup sizes. And now we have a place to get bras. So I'm very excited about this. They have sizes A through H with bands up to 48 inches, so you'll find your right size and shape. Best of all, they have a 100% fit guarantee, and now they have an amazing line of breathable Pima cotton bras and undies, which is what I always get now. I'm totally sold on their Pima cotton. It's super soft, totally breathable, very wearable. I wear with t-shirt, like a good t-shirt bra. No spillage, straps don't dig, perfect fit. Love it. Third Love is going to give our listeners 15% off their first order today by heading to thirdlove.com/AG. That's 15% for your perfect fitting bra at thirdlove.com/AG. Again, that's thirdlove.com/AG for 15% off today. You'll be glad you did. All right, welcome back. Hot Notes. All right, so today for Hot Notes, Jordan has a story about outgoing Chief of Staff John Kelly's thoughts on Trump. But first, Jaleesa, you have a story about House Republicans facing the Dems taking control.
I do, and this is a super hot note. It's a really quick article. So Axios published this on Thursday, and it's called House Republicans' New Reality, which is a really vague title. But basically what they're saying is that the House Republicans are lawyering up. And we already knew that the Democrats were hiring lawyers, but now the House Judiciary Committee posted on a popular Capitol Hill jobs board that they're also seeking an investigative counsel.
A jobs board?
Like, yeah.
Like Craigslist? Hey. Yeah.
I want to check it out. I want to find that post.
Is new president on there?
Let's make it. That's great. We need hackers. So specifically, they're looking for, quote, an attorney with several years of investigative or litigation experience. And according to a source on the Hill, the specific request for litigation experience hints that the House GOP is anticipating the possibility of impeachment proceedings.
Just the ads like anyone, yeah. Can please. Anyone do lawyer stuff? Please, who help? Who can? Anyone will take anyone.
Do you have a suit?
That is the most general terms of requirements.
Looking for someone with legal experience, preferably law degree. Not from Costco.
That's perfect. I kind of feel like we're entering the final round of all of this, because now the Republicans are finally on the defense, right? And they seem to feel the same way, considering that their new shift in attitude that they're having is kind of the result of being powerless. During the gavel handover session, their new minority leader, Kevin McCarthy, he quoted Ronald Reagan saying, basically, hey, can't we all just get along? He was like saying some quote about how we need to come together and put our differences
yeah.
aside.
Up until this point, it was, you assholes, I fucking hate you. Now yeah. he's handing the gavel over. We love you guys. We should work together. I love you.
Exactly.
You look nice. Your hair's good today.
Yeah. Let's not be rash here.
Do you know any lawyers?
Yeah. Trump said the same thing, right? He did his own bullshit about working together when he congratulated Pelosi, which is weird because I'm not saying that like working together is a bad thing. Like obviously that's the goal, but it's a little suspicious when they want to do all the right things after we cut their balls off, right? Like it just seems a little strange. The timing is weird. But that was basically this article just saying that the Republicans are looking for help, seeking lawyer.
Anyone things. Know any lawyers?
Tweet them.
tweet at them. They need lawyers, apparently. All right, Jordan, you got the John Kelly season finale.
Yeah. So the LA Times interviewed the departing chief of staff, John Kelly, last week, and much to our non-surprise, it was filled with not good vibes. The major takeaway from Kelly in this interview was basically, I did what I could to stop him. That's essentially his point. Wow. He said that his time in the White House was best measured by what the president did not do when he was at his side, basically. That's his claim to fame.
Oh, yeah. So, okay. So, judge my success based on all the crazy shit that didn't happen.
Yes. And if you've been following our MSW book club on Patreon, you'll know from our review of Bob Woodward's Fear that this is a huge motif that runs throughout, like many that surround Donald Trump, right? There's a terrifyingly high number of moments where the only thing stopping Trump from doing something completely terrible was one person close to him pulling a Hail Mary to make it so it couldn't happen at the last minute. For example, we learned in Fear that there were multiple times where there were literally papers on Donald Trump's desk to pull out of the trade deal with South Korea. They were ready to sign, and they were literally stolen off of his desk by one of his close staff members.
Porter, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes. And then, by the way, it's like, it's very funny to me that that's all it takes to get Trump to not do something. And it doesn't show much dedication to the thing he's trying to do. He's like that guy that would show up as a bank robber, like, well, it says no firearms. I gotta go. I gotta go.
Womp, womp.
Yeah, foiled again. Unfortunately.
Curses.
Yes.
Foiled again.
They got the decals. Unfortunately, there were and still are things that the president could plow through to fruition despite not consulting the, and I hesitate to say this, experts around him, quote unquote.
Are there any left?
Yeah. For example, Kelly says that Trump instituted the travel ban without fully consulting Kelly first, who was Secretary of Homeland Security at the time, which is really shitty for him because he's the one that has to implement that. Kelly said about that, quote, I had very little time to look at the orders before they were issued, end quote. And that's especially shitty because, like I said, he's the one that had to implement it and had to take all the heat for it. But as we know, Trump doesn't really think about how his decisions will implicate other people because thinking stifles his creativity. He just throws shit out there and sees what it sticks, you know? It's like a...
like a monkey.
Yeah, or like he's like a Jackson Pollock of authority.
Oh.
Yeah. But sorry, Jackson, you're cool.
Throw it on the wall, see what sticks, right? Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Kelly also goes on to say that he got Trump to not pull troops out of Afghanistan, which we also learned about in detail in Woodward's Fear. Highly recommend. Well, I can't say I'd highly recommend that book. I recommend it for the insights, mm-hmm. not so much for the sensical nature of it.
It's right. hard to follow, but I think you might have done that on purpose to just illustrate what it's like to have to deal with Trump.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's really good insights in there, though, like you said.
And if that's not what happened, I apologize to you.
Yeah.
You Pulitzer Prize winning motherfucker.
He's getting older. I'm just kidding. It's great. It's obviously great, amazing reporting. He gets people, like John Kelly obviously contributed to the book. Rex Tillerson, mm-hmm. probably.
Bannon.
Yeah, Bannon.
Porter, it's, for sure.
Yes.
Some weird players to interview, yeah.
Yeah. But regarding pulling troops out of Afghanistan, it now still looks like Trump is going to do so anyway. But no military higher-ups have confirmed that that's what's happening so far. So, who knows. Kelly also tried to separate himself from the family separation policy. He said that Sessions did it, basically. He says, quote, what happened was... Jeff Sessions.
Every lie starts off with what happened.
Well, what sit down. Let me tell you a story. What happened was I ate your hamster.
Mm-hmm. What?
It's a cat meme. Sorry.
Oh. Oh, that's funny. What I was like, you're like, wait, movie I need to see.
No. Just a meme.
So what happened was, this is his quote, was Jeff Sessions. He was the one that instituted the zero tolerance process on the border that resulted in both people being detained and the family separation, Kelly said. Quote, he surprised us, end quote.
Surprise!
Right, not surprising at all that came out of it. Fucking, ugh.
That makes it sound like fun. And it's just mm-hmm. not, it wasn't.
Yeah. So yeah, basically in the interview, he just confirms that he probably did not have a great time doing things, like accomplishing things in that position, spent most of his time mitigating things that Trump was trying to do. And when we think about that anonymous op-ed that came out a couple months ago that everyone was trying to figure out who wrote it, you know, it was very much in that same vein.
Yeah, wasn't
me.
Yeah, he was one of the guys that was there trying to keep him in check.
Just running interference, basically.
Exactly, mm-hmm. yeah.
And those guys are gone now. They've pulled the goalie.
Mm-hmm.
So to speak.
Yeah. Yeah. And Kelly winds up getting asked why he stayed so long, 18 months in the White House, despite such huge policy differences, all of those clashes of personalities, the just daunting task of being around him constantly and dealing with Trump's maniacal ignorance. He said simply, duty. Military people, he said, don't walk away.
Duty. I'm always going to laugh at duty.
It's all good.
We did that in the military. That was a thing. In the military. You got duty tonight? Duty.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Man. Got to laugh when you can. Thank you for that, Jordan.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yes. Interesting. Wow. So he's gone. Bye.
Yep. Bye, everyone's leaving. Did you see someone else from the Pentagon is leaving? Huh. Like the Pentagon, like chief of staff is leaving or something?
Oh, God.
Yeah.
Probably leaving. I figured after Mattis left, a bunch of high up officials in the Pentagon would go with him. They'd be like, I'm not sticking around for this shit.
You know what this feels like? That Titanic moment when like they're on the lifeboats already and it's about to just go up and then come down. Like the last part of the boat. We're in that phase of the Mueller investigation, so right? They're all jumping ship.
But yes.
But yes.
There's a GIF for that. I just can't describe it well.
I know what you're talking about. After it breaks in half and it's standing up on its end.
It's already broken in half.
And you have to kind of jump ship at that point because there's nowhere to stand.
Yeah. Metaphor.
Yes, to fact check myself, Kevin Sweeney, Pentagon Chief of Staff, resigns.
Wow. Nice.
I mean, not nice, but nice remembered mm-hmm. Pentagon Chief of Staff. Mm-hmm. All right, guys. So 4 months ago on August 31st, Samuel Patten pleaded guilty to violating the Foreign Agents Registration Act, also known as FARA, by not registering as a foreign lobbyist for the opposition bloc. That's a pro-Putin party in Ukraine, where he worked for the chief of staff to Viktor Yanukovych. We covered this extensively when it happened. And 4 months after he pleaded guilty and began cooperating with special counsel Robert Mueller's team, Sam Patten is in the news again. Mueller has filed a status report to the court under seal, which is a little unusual considering these sorts of filings for folks like Flynn and Cohen were not filed under seal. They were filed publicly, just redacted. Updates like this usually consist of how much and in what ways a witness is cooperating so the court knows and can consider that cooperation during any upcoming sentencing hearings. So let me tell you a little bit about Sam Patten. Sam Patten is a GOP lobbyist. He's a Manafort associate, a Cambridge Analytica employee. So this guy could be a cooperation gold mine. Yeah, super whore for the Trumps. gold mine for Mueller's team, right? He admitted in his charging documents that he helped foreign donors give money to Donald Trump's inaugural fund. This is like the first evidence that we had of that. Mm-hmm. Sam Patten worked for the same pro-Putin Ukrainian faction that Paul Manafort worked for. Like I said, it was called the opposition bloc. And he was allegedly the boss of Konstantin Kilimnik. And Kilimnik is the other guy named in the Manafort indictment. Some of them. There's so many. And he was the go-between for Manafort and a Russian oligarch that Manafort owed money to, Oleg Deripaska. We all know this. Deripaska is a sanctioned aluminum magnate, and he currently is sanctioned. But here's the thing. The U.S. Treasury Department under Trump is now working to lift those sanctions by allowing him to divest controlling share in his aluminum company, Rusal. The problem is he's selling those shares back to the Kremlin through VTB. So the good news, though, is that we found out on Friday from the New York Times that Congress is examining the Treasury's decision to lift sanctions on Deripaska. And it looks like the Dems in Congress are laying the groundwork to block the lifting of sanctions, beginning with Schumer filing a resolution to disapprove of the sanctions, mm-hmm. Disapprove of the move by Trump's Treasury Department to lift those sanctions. Mnuchin is the guy who is in charge of the Treasury. It's also of note that we learned this week that Boyarkin, as we talked about before, the ex-Russian spy that told Time magazine Manafort had paid back a $19 million debt to Deripaska by giving him private briefings on the Trump campaign, one of which was caught on video by sex coach Nastya Rybka, who is now in a Thai prison, if you remember.
Still?
Yep.
Wow.
She's got a hearing coming up this month.
Okay.
But interesting. Yeah. That's where she is. Sam Patten and Kilimnik started their own lobbying firm in 2015 and were paid a total of over a million smackaroos for lobbying for Yanukovych's chief of staff. Let's see, Loyavochkin. Loyavochkin paid both Manafort and Patten for lobbying for him and Yanukovych. And Yanukovych is the pro-Putin Ukrainian candidate Paul Manafort helped elect Buyukasha, through tactics eerily similar to those used in the Trump campaign, including a smear tactic against his opponent Timoshenko, encouraging people to lock her up. Mm-hmm. And that's where that whole thing started.
They were successful in that one.
Yep, they lost eventually, and he was overthrown and he fled to Russia. But
yeah, he after thought he got that far.
Came out in a wheelchair from
ridiculous.
Prison.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, she was really sick. So Patten basically lobbied the U.S. Congress on behalf of Lyovachkin without registering under FARA. But most importantly is what Patten did in relation to Trump's inaugural fund, right? It's widely known that there were excessive amounts of money in Trump's inaugural, and there's no way his Scott Baio High School marching band Ted Nugent amateur talent show of an inaugural cost more than Obama's. There's just no way. Obama had Beyonce.
He did.
You know, like, and here, you know, here he's got, like, I don't even remember, people that you've never heard of. Patten is, this whole thing is some of the strongest evidence that foreign money was funneled into the inaugural fund, because he used a cutout to transfer $50,000 of Russian money into the Trump inaugural fund by purchasing, quote unquote, inaugural tickets for himself, Kalimnik, Lyovachkin, and another Ukrainian. Patten used the lobbying firm he started with Kalimnik to purchase the tickets through a cutout, and then the firm was reimbursed by a $50,000 wire from the Ukrainian oligarch Cypriot bank account.
That's bizarre.
Yeah, that's how they were getting Russian money into, and this is just one example.
Mm-hmm.
And his whole sentencing update is now filed under seal, and we know Trump's inaugural is being investigated pretty heavily, pretty hardcore, so all very interesting. And one of the most interesting parts is that he used that Cypriot bank account as an intermediary. And many months ago in the Fusion GPS transcripts that Congress made public, we learned that there were notes taken by Manafort on Manafort's phone from the June 2016 Trump Tower meeting that said, use Cyprus as an intermediary.
That's right.
So perhaps this is how they got Russian money to the Trump inaugural, right? Through the a Cyprus intermediary using cutouts in the U.S. like Patten, Intrader, Vexelberg, and Cohen. Just rivers of money from all different foreign sources. But what does it have to do with the Trump Tower meeting that Don Jr. lied about? Well, we know that Manafort and Kalimnik and Patten were associates, and that they used Cypriot accounts to move money. And we also know that Patten lobbied to U.S. Congress on behalf of Lyovachkin, which no doubt included Dana Rohrabacher, a known Russian sympathizer who just lost his reelection bid in the blue wave. Thank you. Finally, we know Veselnitskaya presented her Magnitsky brief to Rohrabacher and at the Trump Tower meetings. So that's a lot of dots to connect, and it speaks volumes as to why this filing for sentencing update from Mueller may have been made under seal instead of available to the public, like Flynn and Manafort's updates. So keep an eye on the Patten case. He is the first person Mueller is charged with dumping foreign money into the Trump inaugural. And don't forget who ran the inaugural fund, Tom Barrack. That's the guy who helped Manafort get the job as Trump's campaign chairman in the first place.
Wow, AG.
Nice.
Yeah.
That's crazy. I love what you've done with just the little bit that we know from, like, that's already so many connections. And then Mueller knows way more than that. Like, he's got, oh my God, they're done.
Yeah.
They're so fucked.
We know 2%.
Yeah.
Is but the going rate.
But what you did with that 2%.
People think, yes.
That's crazy.
You know, hey, connect the dots.
They're real. They're real dots. They're real beans. I just feel like it's crazy that we, from the public information, we have so many connections.
Yeah. And like you said, it's only the tiny, tiniest tip of the iceberg. Mm-hmm. So, are you guys ready for the Fantasy Indictment League?
Yes.
All right, let's see. Who do I pick today? First of all, since we're doing sports metaphors, I wanted to give away who the winner was in our Sweet 16 top stories of 2018 bracket. We've been taking votes all week on the final two, the finals.
Mm-hmm.
And let's see who the winner is. I'm pulling it up right now as we speak. It is... first of all, the two people in the finals were Dems Take the House, not people,
yeah.
Stories. Dems Take the House and Cohen Implicates Trump. Dems Take the House won it 57-43.
Wow.
Huh. Yeah.
Interesting. Personally, at least, I love that won because I would have voted for it to win. I think I did vote for it to win. And I feel like it's because there's so much more we can do with the Dems being in charge than just with that one Cohen case. Like, they can investigate everything, you know, so that's kind of why I think it won.
Yeah, that makes sense. I voted for Cohen just because in terms of incidental news story, I think it's more specifically big news story, but in terms of implications, for sure, it's a bigger deal that Dems took the House.
All right, cool.
And are we doing the new rules for our Fantasy Indictment League this week? Are we doing that we can't take someone else's
pick?
We're
going to do that, aren't we?
Yeah, so what do we flip to see who goes first? I feel like this can... We're
okay,
gonna
so
get competitive.
The new rules is basically us three are just gonna play it. Not you all at home. You can still do it.
You
the
can
same
pick whoever
way
you want.
Doing it, yeah. But we're gonna actually draft as if it were an actual team that we're drafting players from. So if I take Roger Stone, Jaleesa and AG can't take Roger Stone.
Right. Mm-hmm. We're calling dibs. Yeah.
Yeah, this is going to be scary, but I don't know how to figure out who goes first.
Well, who's... let's just go in like alphabetical order. Let's just do... You go first.
And then we'll do it so the last person starts, right? And then like AG... You, me, and then me, you, AG. That's
sounds good.
That's normally how you'd pick in a draft.
Yeah, yeah, that sounds good.
Does it? Is that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay,
go
cool.
back and forth. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All right, sounds good to me. Then I am going to take Stone.
Okay.
Hell yeah.
I'm going with Corsi.
Oh, you dick.
I'm going with Assange.
Oh, you dick. Junior.
Mm-mm. Hell yeah.
Mm-mm. Kush.
Ooh, Kush.
Okay, Ivanka.
All right.
Eric's always last.
He always gets picked last for everything.
Yeah. Dodgeball all over again.
I'm not even taking him.
Tiffany's truly last, though.
You got Corsi, Assange, Stone. I'm going to go with Boyarkin.
Oh, nice. That's good. Oh, okay. With the Patten thing, it's going to be a minute, you think, right?
Well, he's already been indicted.
Oh, okay. Even mm-hmm. that sealed thing is done. It's okay.
That's just an update on his sentencing.
Okay. All right. Mm-hmm. Rando.
Yeah, which is going to be all randos from yeah. here on out.
Superseding indictments, Manafort.
Ooh.
Interesting.
Manafort superseding. I'm going to go with Mangiante.
Mm. Okay.
God, she sucks.
Deripaska's boat hoe.
Yeah.
Okay.
I think we've just been going in a circle, haven't we?
We have, yeah. We That's forgot fine. To do it.
No,
either
okay,
way.
This is fine.
Trump org. They can still get stuff, right?
Yep. You can pick an entity. Trump org. Good one.
I'm going Erickson.
Paul Erickson. I forgot about that motherfucker.
Oh, Butina and the Beast. He's the Beast, I guess.
Yeah, he is.
Definitely not the Beauty.
He's not the Butina.
It'd be funny if it were the other way around, though, because she's evil. I mean, him too, but
yeah.
I'm just going to have a rando now.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right. And I need one more, right?
Mm. Yep. Mm-hmm.
I'm going to go with Burr. I know it's a little far-fetched.
Bill
we'll
Burr?
No. Will Burr Ross. I shortened his first
name. Oh. Burr
yeah,
Ross.
Yeah, Bill Burr.
You're going with Ross.
Yeah. I All should right. pick a celebrity now that Leo is.
He's not a target, though. They made sure to say that he wasn't a target. He was yeah. just helping out because mm-hmm. he's rich and white.
Okay. I'm going to go Rando.
Rando. All right. We got him.
Cool.
So I have Stone, Junior, Boyarkin, Mangiante, and a Rando. Jaleesa, you have Corsi, Kush, Rando, Trump Org, and Burr. Wilbur Ross.
His new nickname.
And you have Jordan, Assange, Ivanka, Manafort superseding indictments, Erickson, and Arando.
Yep.
That's a good team.
Yeah. I love that.
And you guys can pick whoever you want. You don't have to. There's a couple thousand of you playing. So, although there might be a couple thousand people that could be indicted.
Oh, that's true. Yeah.
I just wanted to bring that up. So, are you guys ready for Sabotage?
Yes.
Now, we might have to do Sabotage before the Fantasy Indictment League because it kind of takes away from the Sabotage
yeah,
angle of it.
It does, yeah.
Because the Sabotage, this, and I didn't want to have to go back and change my picks after we were doing our round robin stuff. Mm-hmm. But some weird shit went down at the end of the week with Simona Mangiante. She's the wife of... See, I have this insider information.
Right.
You don't have it. So that's why I'm like, should we do Sabotage beforehand? But she's the wife of Papadopoulos, whose identity has been questioned multiple times, and age.
I got into a Twitter fight with her.
You did?
That's right. Yeah. Dude, nice. That was weird.
What happened?
It was just, she just responded. I like said something. I was like, say hi to your husband in jail or something. And then she responded some shit. And I was like, something about her identity being fake or whatever. And she's like, it's been confirmed by many people. Mm. You're sad. Your life is so sad. That's why you're doing this. So I was like, what the fuck? And then
she turned it around.
Yeah,
right?
She responded like four times. It was so, it was ridiculous.
I'm not 39 trying to make myself 34. So yeah. Whatever. So she's the wife of Papadopoulos, and she's been questioned multiple times, like I said, not just about her age and identity, but where she works, like her internship with a law firm she said she had. And the law firm's like, we don't know who the fuck you're talking about. I've posited that I think she's a plant from the Balkans in some super space beans theories, but she just tweeted, quote, "This is what happens when you get into a federal investigation to support someone who can't be loyal to anything and try to slander me as soon as he wants to run after a new skirt."
Like sands through the hourglass, so are the days of our lives.
These are the days of our lives. right after that tweet, she deleted her Twitter account, or she shut it down, and now it's back up again. So I don't know. That's why I put Mangiante on my fantasy team this week.
I freaking hope so. I hope something happens to her.
Yeah. I'm hoping for your beans too, AG.
Right on. We'll be right back. Hey, Mueller junkies. It's the new year, and that means new resolutions. And we know there's no quick fix when it comes to better health. It's all part of a long ritual of creating new and better habits. And speaking of ritual, Ritual is the obsessively researched vitamin for women. It gives you all of your fatty acids, your omegas, everything. There's no fishy taste. It's got a nice minty taste. I love it very much. And they have all the essentials that we as women don't get most of the time in our diets. So that's part of the obsessively researched part. They find out which nutrients women are mostly missing, and they've put them together in a subscription service, an essential daily vitamin that you get delivered to your door every month. One of the best parts about these vitamins, and for those of you who are obsessed with labels like I am, all of Ritual's vegan-friendly, sugar-free, non-GMO, gluten-free, and allergen-free vitamins help to provide those nutrients that you need that we're missing from our diets. And the subscription is super easy. It's easy to start, it's easy to snooze if you need to snooze it, and it's only $1 a day to have all the essential nutrients your body needs delivered to you every month. So, better health doesn't happen overnight. Start your year with Essential for Women, a small step that helps create a healthy foundation for 2019 and beyond. You can visit ritual.com/AG to start your Ritual trial today. That's ritual.com/AG. You'll be glad you did. All right, guys, welcome back. It's time for the interview. And this week I have the distinct honor of speaking to one of my favorite MSNBC contributors, Barb McQuade. Let's have a listen. So today for the interview, we have a very special guest. I'm very excited. She's a law professor at University of Michigan, which is my football rival. I'm the Ohio State. But that's okay. We love her. She's a former U.S. attorney in the Eastern District of Michigan and an MSNBC contributor. It's Barb McQuade. Barb, welcome to Mueller, She Wrote.
Thanks, AG. Glad to be here.
Awesome. I'm glad. I hope our football rivalry doesn't interfere with our ability to chat about Mueller.
I will do my best to overlook your Buckeye-ness.
Thank you. And I'll do my best to overlook your Wolverine-ness. Both Nancy Pelosi and Jerry Nadler have come out this week saying that the president being able to be indicted is still an unanswered question, right? But the common theory is that Mueller will follow the Department of Justice legal counsel guideline memos saying that a sitting president can't be indicted. And I was wondering where you came down on this issue and if the statements of Pelosi and Nadler make any kind of a difference.
Yeah, I think it's interesting. I think, number one, they're absolutely correct that it is far from a resolved question whether a president can be indicted. And I think it's even far from clear as to whether the DOJ position is etched in stone. A lot of scholars have written about this, and they've pointed out that there are a number of different memos. I think the ones we hear the most about are a memo written by the Office of Legal Counsel in 1973 during Watergate, and again in 2000 during the Clinton administration. But there's also some memos that were filed in litigation in the U.S. versus Nixon case, litigating the tapes, some things written by Leon Jaworski that really makes it kind of less than clear whether the president can be indicted. And I guess it all really comes down to what Robert Mueller does with this guidance. You know, on the one hand, I think he's very much the company man who toes the line and would follow all DOJ policy as he is obligated to do under the regs. But Leon Jaworski said something interesting when he submitted a document to the Supreme Court in litigating the Nixon tapes. And he talked about that it would be a shirking of duty to decide that the president is not eligible for indictment and is somehow immune from indictment and could set a dangerous precedent damaging to the rule of law. And so on the one hand, while I think Robert Mueller is someone who follows the rules, I also see him as someone who does not shirk his responsibility. And so at the end of the day, maybe he decides that indictment is what's appropriate and what his duty calls for.
Yeah, that's really true. I'm glad you brought that up. I remember reading an article about his master's thesis where it wasn't just about the process in the courts and general, you know, rules, but it was also about justice as a big picture. So that's really fascinating that you bring that up. And also the Jaworski issue, because I had a question about that. Recently, Jaworski's roadmap, quote unquote, for releasing criminal information to the House Judiciary Committee from the grand jury came to light. It was unsealed, or I think it was under seal for 4 decades before, but then it came to light. And that roadmap basically allows the secrecy of the grand jury information to be, or it sets a precedent that says it can be released to the House Judiciary. And I wanted to ask you, because you're an expert in these things, if that would have to go through the Attorney General, which is, of course, acting now Whitaker, but could be Bill Barr or who knows what could come of that. But would that Jaworski roadmap have to go through the Attorney General first?
I think it would. So grand jury matters are handled, their secrecy, under a rule called Rule 6E of the Rules of Criminal Procedure. And generally, grand jury material is supposed to be kept secret. But there are a number of exceptions, and some of them include providing them to other government attorneys for legitimate law enforcement or counterintelligence purposes. And so if Robert Mueller thought that there was a need for members of Congress to use this in the course of their official duties, the law permits him to do that. It has to be reported to the judge, and ultimately the judge has authority about whether such information gets released. Now, the regs that govern the special counsel say that the Attorney General should review recommendations of the special counsel, and that he may stop recommendations that go against Department of Justice policy, are so contrary to policy or inappropriate that the recommendation should not go forward. And if he does that, the only check there is that the Attorney General is required to report that to Congress. And so you could see a really interesting situation arise where Robert Mueller wants to turn these materials over to Congress. Attorney General Whitaker says no, but the one safeguard we have there is he has to report that decision to Congress. And so I think Congress could then use its subpoena power to request those documents. That could cause executive privilege battles and the like. So I'm not sure how the answer would come out in the end, but I think it's very interesting. And I think certainly the law is designed to give government officials the ability to share information when justice so requires. And it seems like it would be hard to stop that in the end if this were to see the light of day.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. And now, you know, as we know, Nancy Pelosi took the gavels this week for the House. The Dems took the House in the midterm election. And she named Adam Schiff head of the Intel Committee. And Jerry Nadler, I think, is the presumptive person who's going to be chairing the Judiciary Committee. And he's said, and others have said, that, you know, if this gets somehow blocked, they could just subpoena, or not subpoena, but ask Bob Mueller to come in and answer questions in testimony, public or otherwise. And I was wondering if these kinds of things, you know, situations like that, how do you think the Democrats taking the House might impact the Mueller probe going forward in these scenarios?
Well, I think they could certainly advance the investigation. I don't know that they advance Robert Mueller's investigation specifically. You know, he is continuing to work quietly before the grand jury, which in my opinion is the most effective way to work because it's free of the political process that you see in hearings. You know, in hearings you have members of Congress who are trying to grandstand or make political points and ask questions in a very limited period of time, which is not very effective for follow-up questions. But nonetheless, I think that a difference in leadership can matter in terms of their own investigations. We saw the House Intelligence Committee, for example, under the leadership of Devin Nunes, I think really just completely punted its investigation into Russia, closing their investigation before hearing from a number of witnesses. I know Adam Schiff, who's now taking charge of that committee, has said one of the first things he wants to do is to subpoena the phone records that indicate that Donald Trump Jr. talked to someone on a blocked number as he was negotiating the meeting at Trump Tower, where he was going to talk with Russians about dirt on Hillary Clinton. How anyone could let that go and not want to know who Donald Trump Jr. may have been talking to, I think begs the question, what was the agenda of the prior leadership of the House Intelligence Committee? And so I am hopeful that new leadership will be interested in a quest for the truth rather than enabling a cover-up. And so I do think that that kind of rigor could bring light to the Russia investigation, not necessarily Mueller's specific probe, but the bigger picture of the truth about what happened with our election.
Yeah, exactly. I tend to agree with you on that. And one last thing before I let you go. Can you tell me how you see this sort of playing out this year with Mueller and his reports, and how you see that kind of getting either to the public or not? Do you have any kind of predictions on how it might end?
Well, I think that there's some work to be done before he's complete with all of his work. There's some, this disclosure by Jerome Corsi, the conservative writer, who shared with the public a plea offer that he received from Robert Mueller's team for lying about his advanced knowledge of the WikiLeaks disclosures of DNC emails. No prosecutor makes a plea offer unless he's prepared to back it up if that offer is rejected. And so I think in the short term, at the very least, we'll see an indictment of Jerome Corsi. And of course, his work is intertwined with that of Roger Stone. And so I think if there is sufficient evidence to charge Roger Stone, we'll see him indicted as well. I think some other people to look out for who could be charged are potentially Donald Trump Jr. and Jared Kushner. We know that Michael Cohen has admitted to pleading guilty to lying to Congress about building a Trump Tower in Moscow. And in his sentencing memo filed by the government, they wrote that he provided substantial assistance about a number of topics, including circulating his testimony, among others, regarding the Trump Tower in Moscow. And, who else would be knowledgeable about that but those in Trump's inner circle? Who else has talked to Congress about those things? And those are two of them. I imagine Robert Mueller will be looking at those transcripts carefully to see if their stories lined up with that of Michael Cohen, who was admitted to testifying falsely. If so, I think we could find indictments there for testifying falsely to Congress. And then even more importantly, the question is, why would they have testified falsely? And that gets to the very heart of the matter that Robert Mueller is investigating. I think in the end, he will issue some sort of final report. It will be up to Matt Whitaker or maybe William Barr, if he's confirmed by then, to decide whether that report becomes public. And although there may be some nefarious reasons or even legitimate reasons for keeping it confidential, there's been such keen public interest in this issue that I can't imagine that they could be successful in keeping it secret from the public. And so I'm hopeful that we will see transparency in the end. There may be some details that need to be redacted for national security reasons, classified information and the like. But, let's remember this investigation is not about getting anybody or going after President Trump or any of his inner circle. It's about a quest for the truth, to find out how Russia interfered with our elections. And so I think there's great public interest and should be in learning the truth about that.
Yeah, absolutely. And regarding the Stone, Corsi, Assange, Boyle—I call them Stonehenge. That whole group. From a prosecutorial point of view, are they going to have to solve that Andrew Mueller subpoena battle that's been working its way through the D.C. appellate court before? Do you think Mueller would need to wait till that finished to move on with indicting any of those folks?
Maybe. I guess it depends on what he was hoping to learn from Mueller. It may be that he already has enough evidence from other sources to proceed. I don't think he would have made that plea offer to Jerome Corsi unless he thought he had sufficient evidence, but maybe he needs Mueller before he's able to indict Roger Stone. It's impossible to know what he has. But no doubt that is something that he will want to resolve. Of course, Mueller is someone who was been affiliated with Roger Stone and may have some information. And even if it's not incriminating information that Mueller has, though one would wonder why he would go to the extremes he has if it was not incriminating information, I think Robert Mueller is someone who seems very prudent and careful and cautious and would want to know all possible information before taking action. So it seems that may be what he's waiting for, to find out what is it that Andrew Mueller knows that he is so reluctant to share.
I see. But it is feasible to move forward without a witness.
It is.
Okay. Well, you know, I appreciate you taking the time to talk to us today about this. Your expertise has really given me some insight on how we might move forward. So I appreciate your time. Everybody, U.S. Attorney, former U.S. Attorney in the Eastern District of Michigan, MSNBC contributor, Barb McQuade. Barb, thanks for being on Mueller, She Wrote.
Yeah, thanks. One thing I will say for the record is how much I enjoy your podcast and how much I appreciate your engaging angle to it. It's really important news that everybody should be paying attention to. And I think sometimes people get bogged down in the minutiae and the jargon and the terminology, and you're making it very accessible for a lot of people to learn about in an engaging way. So I appreciate your work to do that.
Oh, wow. Thank you so much. Those are super kind words. I appreciate you coming on to when I watch you on MSNBC, breaking it down so that my non-legal mind can understand what's going on. So thank you as well. I think it's very important.
You sound plenty smart, so thank you.
I'm going to tell everyone you said that. All right, you have a great new year.
Okay, thanks, you too. Bye-bye.
All right, bye-bye. All right, guys, that's our show. That's our season premiere, season 3. I want to thank all of our new patrons. Welcome. We got hundreds this past week. We blew through our goal of 3,000, which means we'll be adding a second news update bonus episode for patrons starting this week. So look for that Wednesday night, Thursday morning, Pacific time. Any final thoughts, you guys?
Be kind to each other.
Yeah.
Be nice in 2019. Don't be like 2018.
Yeah, I wanted to comment on an email we got too. Someone expressed discontent with us talking about our personal lives for 2 minutes in the beginning of our episodes, and I just wanted to say, while we welcome all feedback, thank you for your feedback. It's like a human decency thing, I think. Obviously, we know it's not related to the news, but it's like a Mr. Rogers Neighborhood kind of vibe, you know? Mm-hmm. We're nice to each other. We check in on each other.
We care.
We see how we're doing.
Yeah.
We're a community here.
Whole health.
Yes. Whole health.
Whole health and wellness.
Also self-care. An OBGYN doctor. But yeah, anyway, if anyone else is bothered by that, I'm sorry. I don't think we should stop doing that, though.
No, it's humanizing. I think it reminds me that we're not just robots reading the news. You know, we're people and we're engaging. We're citizens. And I think it's all relevant.
Yeah, that was a weird email. I saw that. Yeah, and I've never gotten one like that before. She's like, I can't even believe it that you talked about your vacations and what you did for the holidays and what, you know, what gifts you got people. I'm here for the news. Like, I've never heard this before in my life. It's a podcast.
Yeah.
Like,
maybe she should listen to it like in double speed.
Yeah,
just
or just
get straight to the
head straight to just the facts.
That's true. You can always skip through the stuff you don't like.
Yeah, we post timestamps.
Yeah,
I had to go back to the other episodes, like in the backlogs. But yeah, I post them so they can check it out and jump around. And
yeah, starting recently, that's what you're doing, Jaleesa. Basically, if anyone's interested, if you go to the episode description, there's timestamps in there, so you can jump forward to the interviews you want to hear. You can jump to just the facts if that's all you want to hear. You don't have to listen to what the fuck we got each other for gifts.
Yeah,
exactly.
If it bothers you that much.
Yes, just on the topic of being kind to each other.
Yeah, it's just
we're just being kind.
Be positive. So much negativity, but yeah, I love our fans though. I love our community.
And I like how we're bitching about it.
Yeah, I mean, she is still a listener. She's a very interesting exception, I think. It was a
weird
situation.
Email.
I mean, yeah, but some people still also comment. They're like, I don't want to hear your personal banter. You
or
know, people say that stuff. Yeah, or you're giggling or whatever. Mm-hmm. I guess I'm just saying we're humans, and thank you for bearing with our humanity.
That's the best way to put it, yeah.
It's terrible that you have to be like, thanks for bearing with our humanity.
Right. There's plenty of podcasts that get straight to the facts. There's The Daily, you know, like there's all these places they can go if they really want that. But I think a part of our brand is that we're just women. We're just, you know, we're doing our thing.
Yep.
Yeah.
And kindness.
It's real chill.
Kindness. Yes.
Go forward. Go forth with it in 2019. Do well.
Yeah.
Do nice things for people. Be kind and vote Democrat. Jesus Christ. Like I said, hit hard in the primaries for whoever you want. Don't take down other Democrats. Just be like, I'm not into their ideas.
Or, right.
That's not, I think this person has better issues and ideas on the platform. Don't be like, don't fall for the Russian propaganda. And I say that because I have. So,
yeah.
You know, just be careful and be kind. And I think that would be good. I've been AG.
I've been Jaleesa Johnson.
I've been Jordan Coburn.
And this is Mueller, She Wrote. Mueller, She Wrote is produced and engineered by AG, with editing and logo design by Jaleesa Johnson. Our marketing consultant and social media manager is Sarah Lee Steiner, and our subscriber and communications director is Jordan Coburn. Fact-checking and research by AG, and research assistance by Jaleesa Johnson and Jordan Coburn. Our merchandising managers are Sarah Lee Steiner and Sarah Hirschberger Valencia. Our web design and branding are by Joelle Reeder with Moxie Design Studios, and our website is MuellerSheWrote.com.